From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Welcome to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I am Dr. David Simel, JAMA Associate Editor and Professor Emeritus of Medicine at the Durham Veterans Affairs Medical Center and Duke University. In this podcast, we will be discussing neonatal hip dislocation. I'm joined today by Dr. Daniel Perry, who is a National Institute of Health Research Professor in the United Kingdom and a professor of children's orthopedic surgery at Alder Children's Hospital and the University of Liverpool. Dr. Perry is the senior author of the Rational Clinical Examination article on neonatal hip dislocation in the April 15th, 2024 edition of JAMA. Thank you for joining us today.
Thanks so much for having me. I'm excited to be here.
Well, Dr. Perry, your review focuses on the diagnostic accuracy of the clinical examination for identifying newborns with hip dislocation. But before we discuss the actual accuracy, can you explain why early diagnosis of this condition is important?
Sure. So dislocated hips in newborns, really we're looking at something called developmental dysplasia of the hip, which is actually a spectrum of disorders ranging from a hip that's quite shallow to a hip that's completely dislocated. But today we're focusing on hips that are completely dislocated, so completely out of the socket. We know that if we catch these dislocated hips early, we can treat them really quite simply. So we can treat them with removable splint, so a splint that an infant wears, that they wear it for 23 hours a day, but parents can take it off to have a bath. And then if we miss it in that very early period, then we have to go ahead and do surgery. And the later we catch it, the more intense, the more complicated that our surgery has to become. So if we don't see it up until 6 months or so, we may have to then do an operation where we open the hip up and put the hip back in the socket. Whereas if we catch it when the child's even later, so a year old, then instead of using a simple splint, we're then doing big surgery, breaking bones, doing osteotomies. And so it's really a really big deal for the child and their family. And in the long term, we know that even though we start doing these big surgeries to put the hip back in the right place, that the later we make the diagnosis, the higher the chance of having arthritis or osteoarthritis in the long term. So about a third of hip replacements under the age of 60 are because of DDH, because of dislocated hips in newborns.
In reviews of diagnostic accuracy of the clinical examination, we have to have a reference standard that's either going to confirm or refute the diagnosis. So what is the reference standard for a dislocated hip?
So there's lots of controversy about what a dislocation is. But the most commonly used reference standard is an ultrasound standard. And in particular, it's a method called the graft technique, which was defined in the 80s. And it's a description that's got quite a lot of complexity to it. But broadly, hips are either normal, they're dysplastic, so they're shallow, or they're decentered. So the hip's dislocated, it's decentered from the socket. So the graft classification based on ultrasound is the reference standard that we used.
When you say shallow, what do you mean?
So shallow hips are where the socket's not completely covering the hip. Within the graft classification, it's graft two hips. The hip's in the socket, so it's centered, but the hip socket's just not completely covering it as it should.
How often does a neonatal dislocated hip occur?
So there's lots of controversy about the actual incidence of disease. So I guess the first thing to say is it's not an acute thing. It doesn't just suddenly happen when the child's born. So it's a gradual deformation of the femoral head that occurs within the infant. Broadly, it affects about 1 in 100 children. But as I say, there's quite a range around that. It's certainly more common in girls. And interestingly, it much more commonly affects the left side, so the left hip. And that's probably because the most common way the baby lies is left occipital anterior. So their left hip's against mum's spine, which is a big stiff structure. And the baby's right hip's against mum's belly, which is a lot softer. So consequently, the left hip gets levered out. And it can be about bilateral in about a third of cases. So based on what we've just seen about the left side being more squashed, so risk factors we think of, so breech also squashes the baby a bit more because the baby's not in the right place. So that's got a higher chance of DDH. Having a family history has also got a higher chance of DDH. So if mum or brother or sister or dad have got it, then it's particularly higher. And then other things that squash the baby. So firstborns, it's a wee bit tighter in there. If there's oligohydramnios, or if the kid's got foot deformity, so other evidence that they've been squashed in utero, all of that has got a slightly higher chance of DDH. With a study we did, looking at our undifferentiated universal screening population, it was actually 0.94%, so 1% roughly of hips were dislocated.
Now that we understand the frequency of the finding, let's move on to talking about the actual clinical examination itself. Can you describe the maneuvers that you would do to detect a dislocated hip?
Sure. So there's a very prescriptive examination. And for interested listeners, they can go to the JAMA multimedia site and we've gone through the examination. But broadly, we get the infant nice and chilled out. So ideally, after they've just been fed, because that's when infants tend to be happiest. We make sure they're fed, we make sure they're settled in a nice warm room so they're nice and comfortable. And then when we're ready to do the examination, we whiz off the diaper. And first things first, we look at their leg length. So we bring their feet together, we flex their hips up to 90, flex their knees up to 90, and we look at the level of their femurs. So we're looking at the length of their femurs to see if one femur is shorter than the other. And so the idea is that if you've got a dislocated hip, so a hip that's dropped out of the socket, that leg's going to look relatively shorter. So obviously the femur is the right size, but because it's not in the right place, it's going to look shorter. And then we move on to abduction. So we'll separate the legs, we'll part the hips and abduct them. And we're looking for a difference between the two hips, essentially, to see if there's any difference in abduction. Obviously the pickle there with both of those things is if it's bilateral disease, then even though they're dislocated, both legs will look the same length and will abduct similarly. But if you've got more commonly unilateral disease, so one-sided affected, then you'll have limited abduction on the affected side. We'll then move on to test the stability. And the common ways of looking at stability is called the Barlow and the Ortolani maneuver. And so Barlow was a bad guy. Barlow dislocates hips and Ortolani's our hero. So Ortolani clunks the hips back in the right place. When we're doing that maneuver, it's quite common to hear lots of clicks because the tendons and everything kind of snaps around. But it's really the big clunks we're trying to feel, that big clunk as the hip pops back in the socket.
So during the exam, you're actually trying to dislocate the hip?
Yeah, absolutely. That's what Barlow maneuver does. We adduct the hip, we push down, and the hip falls out of the back of the socket.
And then the Ortolani part of the procedure is getting it back into place.
Yeah, so with Ortolani, we abduct it, but more than just abducting it, we're abducting it. And at the same time, we've got my index finger would be at the back of the infant's trochanter. So as we're abducting it, I'm also flicking it up with my index finger as well to lift the hip back into the socket.
I'm thinking like an adult, because when I hear that, it sounds like it's painful.
No, it's not at all painful. So obviously we don't want to repeat it lots and lots of times, but it won't be uncomfortable for the infant. They tolerate it very, very well. It's just one of those things.
When you do the Barlow-Ortolani procedure and compare it to ultrasound as your reference standard, what is the sensitivity and specificity of that test for hip dislocation?
So in the study that we've done, the sensitivity of the Barlow maneuver, Barlow-Ortolani combined, because we often consider it as a combined maneuver, the sensitivity was 46% and the specificity was 99.1%. And I guess given our prevalence of having a dislocated hip was 0.94%, what does that actually mean? Well, for me, what it actually means is if we were to examine 1,000 infants, or if someone that does it a lot was to examine 1,000 infants, they'd identify 4 dislocations, they'd miss 5 dislocations, and it would also result in 9 additional scans, so 9 unnecessary ultrasound scans and 9 normal ultrasound scans.
You mentioned during the exam that you may hear clicking, and I gather you might feel popping. Are those useful signs?
So we looked at clicks, so we looked at the sensitivity and specificity, but really there's no real value in feeling a click or trying to base anything on the click. They're not useful signs. Clinicians will try and differentiate a click from a clunk because they argue that a clunk is a really kind of big noise as the hip pops back in. But in reality, that's really, really hard to teach. And therefore, I don't think we can really put any value on any real noise that the hip makes.
When is the best time to screen the child for a hip dislocation?
So the way that they're generally screened is they're generally screened at birth because we've got population that's there in hospital that's captured. In addition to that, most screening programs will screen the infant again between sort of 4 and 8 weeks, somewhere around there. And in both of those situations, you should be able to feel a dislocated hip or certainly unstable hip.
For the child with a dislocated hip, are there any concerns that the parent might describe to you that would give you a clue that a hip dislocation is possible?
at the first well-child check, there's not a great deal that the parents are going to pick up that's abnormal. It's a relatively subtle sign or relatively subtle thing that we'll find on clinical examination, particularly by expert examiners, but there's nothing obvious to the parents, and it's really going to come from the clinical examination and the risk factors.
What are the various approaches around the world to screening for neonatal hip dislocation?
So there's huge amounts of controversy, and it's one of the areas, certainly within orthopedic surgery or children's orthopedic surgery, where there is quite so much controversy, and there's huge amounts of passion about how we should treat it on all different ways. So if we look at Austria, which is where the graft technique came from, so the technique that we've adopted as our reference standard, then all of the infants in Austria will have an ultrasound when they're first born and get an ultrasound again at 6 to 8 weeks to make sure that hip's in the right place. Whereas in the UK and the US, we've adopted this selective program whereby children get a clinical examination and assessment of their risk factors, and then subsequently we'll have an ultrasound based on the results of risk factors or clinical examination. And yeah, there's lots of passion and controversy amongst surgeons. We children's orthopedic surgeons think we'd like everyone to have an ultrasound screening, but obviously that comes with problems as well, because that comes with the risk of overdiagnosis, that comes with increased cost. So there's lots of uncertainty if that's truly the right way. Whilst we've got a passion for not seeing dislocated hips in infants, I think the jury's out on what the right approach is to screening.
Dr. Perry, is there anything else you would like our listeners to know about screening for neonatal hip dislocation?
The main thing to come out of this paper was just to show that clinical examination really isn't perfect for this. But there's huge amounts of debate and passion amongst surgeons to really optimize the screening pathways and optimize the treatment pathways.
Well, thank you, Dr. Perry, for joining us today to talk about neonatal hip dislocation. This episode was produced by Daniel Musisi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thanks for listening.